हेलो एंड नमस्ते टू ऑल ऑफ यू. आई गरिमा शुक्ला ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ टीम जियो विज्ञान वेलकम यू ऑल टू द फिफ्थ टॉक ऑफ द इंटरनेशनल सीरीज ऑन अर्थ साइंसेस. सो फॉर टूडेज टॉक वी हैव विद अस प्रोफेसर सूर्य प्रकाश, हु इज प्रोफेसर एंड हेड इन द जियो मेट्रोलॉजिकल रिस्क मैनेजमेंट डिवीजन, नेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ डिजास्टर मैनेजमेंट, मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ होम अफेयर्स, गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया. He is a nodal faculty for 9 central ministries for coordinating disaster management activities, including Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas, Coal, New and Renewable Energy, Communication, Mines, Shipping, Labor and Employment, Parliamentary Affairs, and Northeastern States. He was the coordinator for the Indo-Japanese Action Plan on Landslides and Disaster Management as part of the Security Declaration between the governments of India and Japan, signed by the Prime Minister of both countries. He has been recognized as a qualified professor geologist by the India Bureau of Mines, a licensed HAM by the Department of Telecom, and is a member of the International Consortium of Landslides Japan. He is the national coordinator for IAPG, International Association for Promoting Geoethics Italy in India, and he has more than 150 publications as papers, books, reports, and articles. He has also been a recipient of UGC's National Merit Scholarship and CSIR Fellowships during his studies, and he obtained his doctoral degree from IIT Roorkee. So before starting the session, there are some important instructions to our participants. So the attendance and feedback form will be shared to you in the YouTube live chat box. In order to receive the certificate, you have to fill both the forms. So now, sir will speak a topic, landslide risk assessment and slope management. So, Professor Surya, sir, it's up to you now. You can start, please.
Thank you, Garimaji. And first of all, good morning and a warm welcome to first the host organizers, the members of GeoBigyan, and all the participants and experts and resource persons, functionaries who have all joined with us today at Google Meet or in YouTube. And you know that this is a season for landslides and floods. Many events have already been reported even during this year. Several casualties had happened in Maharashtra, and also several flood incidents have been happening in Karnataka, Bihar, Maharashtra, Assam, and other areas. So today we will be focusing on landslides, which are one of the types of geohazards which has the highest potential mitigate, to prevent, and to prepare against the risks that are likely to happen to mankind. So we will talk about that. Through a presentation, I will taking you first of all about the history of such disasters. Garima, I think the share link is not well active. Just let me check. I'm trying to share the window. Yeah, now I think it is. So kindly let me know when the PowerPoint is available. Because yes, it's likely to take some time because of the views known.
Yes, sir, your slides are visible.
The slides are visible. That's good. I think it worked well, better. Then what I was telling you, that landslides are one of those geohazards which have the highest potential in terms of cost-benefit ratios in risk assessment, prevention, mitigation, and preparedness, particularly, which are our proactive steps against any disaster risks. And also, we can protect ourselves in advance and make ourselves resilient if we know about the nature of the phenomena and the factors or the conditions governing its occurrence. So we'll talk about. Yeah.
Sir, can you put that slide in the full screen mode?
Oh, yes. I will start with that.
Yes, sir.
I will go to the slide slowly, because okay. Before that, I wanted to give you some background that why this kind of webinars, trainings are very important. That changed the context little bit from just landslide risk assessment and slope management to environment, climate change, development, sustenance and resilience. Because these are all integrated together and we cannot talk about them separately. So we have to understand our environment around us and changing climatic conditions, and whatever developments we are doing, are they really the right kind of development, or are they bringing the disasters or generating new disasters? So these are some of these issues. And this is an international webinar, I'll go with some international strategies and action points and then come to the national level scenarios. So before I begin with the landslides, it is my humble duty, being from a National Institute of Disaster Management, Ministry of Home Affairs, which is a nodal ministry for disaster management, to talk about the current prevailing pandemic situation and to make a request to all participating in this webinar to take few essential steps to break the chain and stop the spread of this disease and save lives. So these are some of the steps which we have been prescribing, that wear your mask properly whenever you are in public places or in a group. Kindly do wear your mask. Second, wash your hands with soap and water or some sanitizer as frequently as possible, because we oftenly touch various objects and our face oftenly, which is recommended not to be repeated. So we are also telling that avoid touching eyes, nose and mouth to the extent possible. These are the openings through which the virus can enter into your body. And transmission of the virus is from human to human. So a distance of 2 meters has been prescribed to keep break the chain of the spread of the disease. And then now, after the unlockdown, many people are going to the offices and touching various objects. So when you are doing so, clean surfaces regularly with some sanitizer, okay, so that it doesn't spread. And now finally, we are also there with vaccine, and the 2 doses of vaccine must be taken by all citizens of the country, and anywhere else, wherever they are, they should actually take the vaccine against COVID-19. So no carelessness until we are sure for our safety of the lives. And the second point I want to bring to your information is, most often we think that these are natural processes, whether the existence of a virus or a fungi, or maybe a landslide or a flood. These are natural events that are actually going to their extreme levels, but they are turning into a disaster when our human resources or activities or functions come in interface with them. So why they get exposed and get affected is because of our fallacies, ignorance, or unintended mistakes. So there is a Czechoslovakian proverb which states, misfortunes enter when window is left open to them. So whatever development I talk to you, you are doing, we should see that we should not leave any space for disasters to happen there. So it should be a disaster safe development, rather than disaster resilient development, if you cannot completely avoid or prevent these events. I would like to explain this through this map. Garima ji, all these slides are going well, no?
Yes, sir. It's visible.
Yeah, yes. Because sometimes the slide stops. Kindly let me know when there is no direct connectivity between the slide and the talk, okay?
Okay, sir.
So what I'm showing you, that when we talk about hazards or disasters, we are always talking in terms of multi-hazard issues. And when we are going global, we look into the distribution of these natural hazards, they are very much similar in various parts of the world, depending on the local geographical geoclimatic conditions. And if you see this map, even USA, China, India, all are equally affected by the distribution of different types of events which cause disasters. Now you see the second map, which is actually indicating the number of affected people. Now the USA is least affected compared to China and India. Now what actually led to this, that despite the similar number of events, the impacts are less in some areas or some countries, whereas the impacts are much higher or severe in other countries or other parts of the world. So this difference is because of primarily the awareness and preparedness as well as mitigation measures that has been undertaken by these countries, which where the impacts are less. Whereas in the other countries, adequate initiatives have or interventions have not been appropriately undertaken. Now, how these initiatives started? If you look from the international level, actually they started with the declaration which happened on 22nd December 1989 in the UN headquarters when they were discussing about why the developing countries, despite all their hard efforts, are not able to reap the benefits of their growth. So during those discussions, it emerged that it was because of disasters that strike and which erode away all the gains of their developments. So at that time, on that day, it was decided to launch an international decade for natural disaster reduction, which was termed as IDNDR. So this initiated with the January 1990, 1st January, ended on 31st December 1999. And several initiatives were taken up by various member states, and they held various programs, projects and activities to understand the nature, distribution and impacts of disasters. Now, while this was going on, at the time, UN also created a secretariat which was termed as UNISDR, that is United Nations International Strategy for Disaster Reduction, which is now renamed as United Nations Office for Disaster Reduction, Risk Reduction. So now that has been changed. But in between, Japan came forward as one of the countries which is worst affected by several kind of natural hazards. And they proposed to the UN that we will hold the first world conference on natural disaster reduction. And it was held at Yokohama in May 1994. From there, an international strategy, which was termed based on the place where this event was held, the first world conference, as Yokohama strategy, and the plan which was proposed was termed as Plan of Action for a Safer World. The basic main approach was towards the natural disasters, natural risks. And then it was followed up after every decade in the form of Second World Conference and Third World Conference. From each conference, the review was undertaken for the past years and the actions taken and the benefits accrued out of that, and the strategies were modified accordingly. Now, after 1994, the second one was held in January 2005 at Kobe. Kobe is one of those places where an earthquake had happened in January 1995 and killed thousands of people. And on the 10th anniversary of this earthquake, this event was held in January 2005. And from where the Hyogo Framework for Action 2005-15 emerged, and it was followed up even in India. And then in the World Conference, Third World Conference, fortunately I could attend that, another declaration was done and a framework was proposed. It was held at Sendai. Sendai, you may remember, 11th March 2011, there was a tsunami which turned into a triple disaster. That tsunami was actually triggered by an earthquake, and later on it led to flooding and also a nuclear disaster. So this has caused a lot of losses of lives as well as damages of infrastructure. And the Japanese held this Third World Conference there, and all the more than 6,000 delegates were there, which actually contributed towards the development of the Sendai framework for DRR, and a declaration was made. And this is a brief overview of all in one sheet, which was actually proposed in short in terms of a goal to prevent new and reduce existing disaster risk. Means we should not introduce new disasters. We should try to avert and prevent them. And also, whatever existing disaster risks are there, we should take adequate steps or interventions against them to reduce their level of severity and the impacts through integrated and inclusive economic, structural, legal, social, health, structural, cultural, educational, environmental, technological, political, and all kind of institutional measures that prevent and reduce hazard exposures and vulnerability to the disaster, increase preparedness for response and recovery, and also strengthen our resilience. So that is the goal that was fixed up, and four priority actions were also proposed. And these four priority actions were actually the four major steps that are prerequisite for any disaster risk reduction and resilience process. The first one was understanding disaster risk. Second one was strengthening disaster risk reduction for resilience. Third one was investing in disaster risk reduction for resilience, because without money, no action is possible. And the fourth one was enhancing disaster preparedness for effective response and to build back better in recovery, rehabilitation, and reconstruction. And seven targets in order to monitor the actually efficacy of these actions were also fixed. And these were in terms of number of deaths that are happening because of disasters, number of affected population, economic losses, damages to medical and educational facilities. And there were three more targets, which are in terms of strengthening the mechanisms to resist, to prepare and to recover from disaster situations, which involved national and local strategies, support to developing countries, and also access to early warnings information. Early warning, we say, a stitch in time saves nine. So the number of different stakeholders which were involved, and I just briefed you about this. In 2015, yeah, anything?
Well, can you hide that notification which is appearing at the bottom of your screen, that meet.google.com?
Okay, okay, yes, yes, sure. Yes, sir. Is it okay now?
Yes, sir, it's okay now.
2015, at the global level, we had the second agreement. Third World Conference was held from 14th to the 18th of March 2015. In September, we had Sustainable Development Goals, which is actually an advanced feature of our Millennium Developmental Goals, and 17 goals were decided. And sustenance also means not compromising with the needs of the future generations and going for development to meet the current or present day's needs. And these goals, which were put up in the Sustainable Development Goals, were also in coherence with our Sendai framework for disaster risk reduction. And until and unless we take care of all these in integration, we'll not be able to achieve these goals or achieve the targets of Sendai framework. And the third major important agreement which took place at global level was the Paris Climate Agreement in 2015. And this was also one of the issues that natural meteorological processes are also changing over a period of time because of human interventions. We had released so much of gases into our atmosphere or heat into our atmosphere or made changes in our land use and land cover in a way that overall average annual global temperatures are rising. And that's also leading to uneven or unexpected distribution of rainfall in terms of intensity and distribution or onset of the rainfall seasons. And all these are resulting into sometimes extreme weather events and ultimately into disaster situations. So these all are actually interrelated to each other, and Honorable Prime Minister also took it seriously, and he himself also participated in that program in the Conference of Parties 21. And the last part was the urbanization agenda, which also was discussed in 2016. And if you look at our own national population in the urban areas, is very much increasing because of the various requirements of the population, and they are actually migrating from rural to the urban areas. Now, how these migrations are leading to exposure and vulnerabilities of the population in the hazard prone areas. I'm showing you some of these maps, flood map, earthquake map, landslide map, I will show you cyclone maps or like that. And these are showing the distribution of various hazards in different parts of our country. Now, due to these migrations, the people, because of their economical, cultural, social backgrounds, have to settle in hazard susceptible areas. And that's why they get exposed. And now they are not exposed just only to one type of hazard, but multiple type of hazards prevailing in those areas. So when I talk as a disaster manager, I have to look into the safety of lives of the people, economy, environment, infrastructure, from all kind of potential hazards within a given period of time and within a given place. So we also similarly prepared landslide generation maps, and we have also evaluated how much areas under which kind of hazards fall within the country. Similar things have been done at the global level by the international organizations like NASA. They prepared the global disaster maps, or there are insurance companies which have prepared the global hazard maps or disaster maps. For example, Munich Re, Swiss Re. So all these are available. Because of shortage of time, I have not put up and will not discuss. But I'm just showing you that the amount of area under a particular hazard and the percentage can be ascertained and has been done by our expert groups and respective nodal organizations. Now, what is actually changing is the dynamicity of the phenomena. Certain phenomena, as I said, climate change is changing, whereas geophysical phenomena, the Earth's own geodynamics, seem to be quite consistent compared to geoclimatic conditions. So geodynamic and geoclimatics have different connotation. With that variation, we cannot actually have a static map of any hazard or susceptibilities. So that's why we need to change and also look into the cascading impacts or secondary impacts. One kind of hazard, for example, flood can lead to landslide, or landslide can lead to a flood, flash flood situations, or an earthquake can lead to a landslide, landslide blocking a river, creating a landslide dammed lake, and that can get burst in form of landslide dammed lake outburst floods, and then later on damages to infrastructure. All these kind of parameters were also considered by our international panel on climate change. And they also proposed an integrated model to mainstream the climate change development and disaster risk reduction together in the form of this kind of STAR, where they have talked about weather and climate events, vulnerabilities, exposure and disaster risk. So number of such models are available, and some of the evidences of these changes triggering the disaster events is the event which took place in first week of August 2009 in Leh, which is a high altitude desertic area and has an annual rainfall of less than 100 millimeter per annum. But then they had received more than that rainfall in a day's time. And they were living in sun-baked brick buildings, which got dissolved, and all the buildings collapsed, and people became homeless. And this was the situation in that place. And all this become very muddy, and it was very difficult to even respond to save the lives of the people who were trapped or who were buried underneath these debris. Another major event which you may recall was June 2013. That was on 16th of June when a major flash flood took place in the Mandakini Valley, and the threats were felt up to the downstream levels in Haridwar and Rishikesh. So thousands of people, they became trapped, and many lives were lost who were came in their way. Similarly, forest fire instances. California recently has reported a huge forest fire that burnt numerous trees. And it not only bring the burning of the trees, but also loss of the carbon, that is accumulated within these plantations. So we are actually now through this burning process releasing carbon dioxide, methane, sulfur, nitrous oxide, etc. Several gases, which we term as greenhouse gases, which again are affecting our environment and also increasing the temperature in those areas. So these events have also changed and increased their frequencies. Now look into all these issues. At the national level in India, after the Sunday framework, it was declared there itself by the then our Union Home Minister, Shri Rajnath Singh. He currently is the Defence Minister, but at that time he was the Home Minister. And we had the first Asia Ministerial Conference. And this first Asia Ministerial Conference was held at New Delhi with more than 55 countries. And Honorable Prime Minister had given us 10-point agenda. So these are actually broader multi-hazard perspective which I am talking to you. Because time is short, so I'll skip this slide. All this information is available on the web. You can find it at PMO office website. You can find it at NIDM website, nidm.gov.in. or NDMA website. So let me skip this in order to focus on landslides. Now let me come to the landslide situation in our country. We talked about the global scenarios. We talked about the multi-hazard approaches, strategies and frameworks right from 1990 till date. Now, what is happening in the hill areas of our country or other countries, for example? You can see this is a photograph taken by me in Shimla in the year 2006 when I went there for a training program. To conduct a training, I found the Shimla has actually got a growth of buildings much higher and widespread. And there is no space in between the buildings. If a landslide happens on such slopes, how would you manage it? Or how would you ensure the stability of those slopes? So all those people who are living within those buildings or the highways going through those buildings or through these hills are likely to get affected. And it had happened really, and several times the people were victims, and not only the buildings got collapsed, but also the highways, they were blocked and damaged. And if I look at from the northwest, I talked about Shimla. If you go to northeast, this is from Gangtok, Sikkim area. Comparatively, the structural designs are different. They were more traditional in Himachal Pradesh than in Sikkim. They had RCC buildings, and they were also very high-rise buildings, and they were also located on unstable slopes. In a similar way, the intensity of the buildings, the density of the buildings, both horizontally and vertically, was very intense. So that actually leads to human interventions, which I was talking to about misfortune center when windows left open to them. So we are actually creating those windows for disasters to happen through such developmental activities. And take another example of the northeastern state like this. So even in traditional designs, this is from Nagaland area. So different areas, you see different type of structure, elevated structure with soft stories. The buildings do not have adequate base and foundations. And when the slopes fall, this is from Nainital area, where this landslides happening for a long time, Balianala. And people lives, they are always at stake and feel threatened whenever there is a rain. There is a likelihood of a slippage or a landslide. So these are kind of situations. Looking into these situations, national policy on disaster management, it was released on 22nd October 2009, and we have also dwelt in National Disaster Management Plan in November 2019. And looking into the specific issues of landslides, at the national level, we had worked upon development of guidelines on management of landslides and snow avalanches, which are kind of mass movements. And also recently, this landslide guidelines were issued in June 2009, and later on, landslide risk management strategy has also been developed, and which was released on the formation day of NDMA, 27th September 2019, by the National Disaster Management Authority. And these are some of the different steps which were proposed under national guidelines while these were being formulated. It took almost 3 years, from 2006 to 2009, to develop these guidelines. And it involved all the assessments related to the hazard generation, landslide inventories, and also the actions being taken and initiatives being led by different organizations. So based on that, these issues were discussed, wherein the landslide hazard and risk assessment was also talked about, landslide remediation, regulations and for enforcement, including the Bureau of Indian Standard Codes, knowledge networks, research and developmental status, training building capacity building, emergency preparedness, and integration of this approach with the development and public awareness and education, the steps in the guidelines. While in the strategy, the landslide hazard mapping need to be strengthened and increased. Then mapping is not enough. We need to monitor also and establish early warning systems for landslides. And information should also be available with the affected communities. So awareness generation is another key area which were identified. And training capacity building, again, no doubt, was considered as important. And besides this, to regulate the land use and construction practices or developmental practices in the landslide prone areas, mountain zone regulations and policies were also thought about. And finally, national level mitigation projects or pilot case studies or case examples need to be taken up as special purpose vehicles to demonstrate best practices or the bad practices within the country. And this is the map which was prepared during the preparation of the guidelines, showing, indicating different degree of hazard, landslide hazards in different parts of our country. And you can see the northern, northwestern, northeastern parts are more affected, then followed by our western coast and eastern coast, and then the midlands of our country. And this incidences map have been recently revised by our Building Materials Technology Promotion Council, and they had tried to project the available data through GIS platform. And if you look into the distribution of these landslides, you will find Himalayan parts are more vulnerable compared to the northern eastern region, and then followed by Western Ghats and Nilgiris, Vindhyans, Eastern Ghats, and Highlands. So these impacts over the space are not uniform over a temporal window. You will see that at different years or different periods of the year, the different intensity, frequency and severity of landslides takes place. I'm just showing you a 5-year study which was done related to landslides in India from 2007 to 11 by me, which I've tried to relate the number of landslide events with the number of people injured or missed and number of people killed. You will find in the graph below that it is not uniform, and also the number of occurrences of the landslides within different years is also not uniform. Certain years they had more landslides, maybe due to higher rainfall or local intervention by the human beings. And the number of casualties sometimes are higher in terms of late season landslides than the early season landslides, which are shallower, and late season landslides are quite deep and carry more mass compared to the shallow and small scale landslides. Now, in the country, these studies had actually started way back during the British periods, when the Sher Kadh Dandal landslide was first reported in 1867 in the Himalayan Gazetteer, also recalled in 1880, when 151 people they got killed, out of which 108 were our Indians and 43 were British nationals. Then this event actually happened on 18th September 1880. If some of you had visited Nainital, you will see a playground very close to the Nainital Lake. And this playground actually is nothing but the debris brought by that landslide at that time. This is a historical photograph of the landslide at Sher Kadh Dandal in 1880. And these are the another infamous landslide is Kalyasur landslides. This I'm just showing you photograph. Now 2013 the flood event I talked to you. I was there in Uttarakhand from 11th to 17th of June. I was personally a witness to the flood event, and I had to cross and come back to Delhi. And I had a workshop in Shimla on 18th and 19th. But somehow 17th was Sunday. The event brought so much impacts that I was called back from Shimla and asked to go back to Uttarakhand. And I had to cross this road with the number of landslides which were triggered by the flood event, and with my own car, driving myself. And you just showing you photograph that I took at 11 a.m. That was on 21st June, and 4:30 p.m. on 21st June. So you can imagine, if a person driving, he will go directly into the Alaknanda when this event takes place. So your familiarity with the ground, with the phenomena, is very much important. And when it's likely to happen is also equally important. So I had to cross and go back to my destinations, knowing fully well that this is a very nuisance landslides and likely to recur and happen at this particular spot, at this particular window of time. Similarly, Malpa landslide, many of you have heard about, which happened on the midnight, or you can say early morning of 18th August, and killed more than 200 people, including the famous dancer Pratima Bedi. And this landslide brought so much debris that most of these people got buried underneath it. Betty Pandor landslides, which took place in Ukhimat area of the Chamoli district of Uttarakhand, caused casualty of 107 people. And this landslide was so fast that not only it blocked the Mandakini River, but also overrided on the slopes on the other side. So that is the kind of impacts you can see. Fata, I remember 2001, 27 people had got killed. And this was the situation there at Fata. So many landslides, and even the vehicles were also buried underneath the debris. Laj Hekla, it was August 2009, 43 people, they got buried. And their bodies even could not be recovered. These were the three villages, Laj Hekla and Natin, in the Natchin Manchari area, which were there. Now you cannot see even the trace after the event. And recovery of the bodies from such a debris is really a major challenge, not only to the local people, but also even our rescue and response agencies. No such trainings have been actually given to rescue people who are buried underneath the debris. We have trainings on collapse structure, search and rescue, but not on the people buried underneath landslides. It's very difficult to locate them, identify them, and save them timely. So you can see their body parts can get even pierced and cut off because of the blunt stones that fall along with them. So sometimes even body parts are reported, sometimes this thing. And Shungar, very sensitive, emotional case, where 18 children between the age of 5 to 12 years got killed on 18th August 2010 when they went to the school to study because of a landslide. So you can see all these, that this was a school building which had a single brick wall from the back. A landslide hit the wall and entered the room. And somehow the teacher was out and she had knuckled the door from the outside, and children could not come out. So there are cases of different types. So innocent children like that have also become victims. So, and access route to such areas is really very, very difficult and challenging. And these are the children, just showing you some of the flood situations. One of the landslide, very, very famous landslide, where maximum investments have been done on civilized area for the protection and prevention or mitigation purposes. And this landslide, this is a photo taken on 25th September 2003, just a day before the event happened. You can see the day next, 26th September photo. So these big landslides with so many buildings on the foothills, which are likely to get exposed. And more than 400 buildings, in fact, were exposed by this landslide, which started from the top of the mountain, almost 500 to 600 meter above, from a forested area. So you can see, these are the buildings which were, again, photo taken on 25th September, some hotels. And you can see 26th September. You cannot even find the traces. So I'm just showing you how we have been affected, and only landslide, even the bulldozer and the labor, they were taken away by this landslide. So, and it was again more than 500 meter height. So Aizawl landslide on 11th May 2013 killed 17 people. PWD building, whole of the building fell on other buildings, private buildings, and people got killed within those buildings, and buildings got completely. Bastari, I remember in Uttarakhand, I had a program at CBR Roorkee for the landslides, and the night before, we learnt on 1st July at 4:30 a.m., 14 people, they got buried alive. And these people actually, at night, some people were buried and they cried, and some people locally did save those people from that landslide event. But later on, the people who actually saved others also became part of the landslide victims, and all of them got buried alive. And this was the city, this was the place, Bastari village, where this event has taken place. And later on, our ITBP, NDRF and others went and tried to resolve. This was the situation in 2013, and this is even border roads, strategic concerns are also there. And these are multi-time landslides which have been moving along. I'll just show you one instance. When people normally, landslides happen, they cross through the roads over the landslides and take another vehicle. I'm showing you an eyewitness of a bus where which was parked close to a landslide, and a boulder moved down from the adjacent slope of the landslide and it fell on this bus. Luckily, a lady saw from the distance that a boulder is rolling down from the slope, and her husband was inside this bus. She cried to get out of the bus. Immediately, there were 13 passengers. They came out. As soon as they came out, quickly, this boulder fell on this bus. And this was the situation immediately afterwards. So you can, it looks like it has been blasted, but not blasted, but bombarded by the falling rockfall stones, boulders. And this was the slope. Reservoir areas, Heidel project. So all these actually are introducing poor water pressures, instabilities, and causing landslides. And road construction close to the river areas. All these are making our infrastructure vulnerable to the impacts of the landslides. I remember Lambgad landslide, which happened in July 2005, actually broke the Alaknanda River at night, transitory. And after that, the blockade was burst. The road along with that landslide debris moved downwards. And the people, more than 5,000 persons who were there in Badrinath, they got trapped there. And they were rescued through a tunnel later on. Similarly, it happened in Yamunotri Valley also. Yamuna Valley landslide, Kaneda landslide, which is termed as upstream of Badkot area, actually blocked the Yamuna River, and then it posed risk to the bridge also on the upstream side. So similarly, your tunnel structures get exposed to landslide. When it blocks, it creates temporary transitory lakes, and that water and debris enters into the tunnels, which are located upstream of that. And that actually stops the functions of those tunnels and the functions of those. This is from the Himachal Pradesh, Satluj Valley. And since it is an international webinar, cross-border issues are also there. We had to face the consequences of the Parichu Lake, which was located in Tibet area. And this is actually a landslide dammed lake, and it got busted. And after it busted, the water in the downstream came to India. And all our structures, bridges, roads were affected. Somehow, our remote sensing agencies, they had actually done good estimation, and they could project the level of flooding in the Satluj River due to the busting of this lake. And they could not avoid the impacts on the fixed structures, but they could reduce the losses of the lives. You can see the structures hanging in the air, or the road completely gone away after this flood on 26 June 2005, or the piers of the bridge that got bent. So these are the kind of situations. Another situation which come across, the very talked about flood situation was 1917 Alaknanda flood, which took place on 20th August. And these floods are actually happening in the narrow valley areas where the confluence of two tributaries happen, two or more tributaries happen, and they bring water as well as the sediments together. And because of the narrow portion, this area actually creates a temporary dam and withholds the water. And later on, when the water pushes or creates pressure on this dam, it bursts and then brings a heavy flash flood, thereby washing away all the bridges on the downstream side, whether it is girder bridge or suspension bridge or a concrete bridge. And more than 300 villages, in fact, were affected by this Patal Ganga Alaknanda River flood. And then earthquake induced landslides. Remember, 18th September 2013, we actually witnessed many examples of building collapse. One, due to the earthquake vibrations. Other is due to landslide which got induced by the earthquake vibration that was seismically triggered or reactivated landslides. And despite even the good designs or good constructions, the buildings have failed because the slopes underneath them have failed. So the stability of the slopes under the seismic conditions is equally important as under the variable water conditions or poor water pressure conditions or undercutting conditions. I remember another example which I witnessed in Turkey, where in mass movements of the buildings took place because the underlying rocks, they were overlain by a thick debris over which the buildings were constructed. This was part of the eastern Turkey. And you don't see a distinct scar, but you can see the overriding slopes and also the change in the buildings, spacings and others, and hotels releasing water. And how we are sometimes doing this more than what the nature does. And one of our calculations indicated that it is more than 15 to 20 times that we can infiltrate water through our domestic and commercial buildings like hotels into the slopes, and thereby destabilizing them compared to what the infiltration from the rainfall does. So these buildings were releasing water and destabilizing. And another example of a major landslide which happened at midnight around 12:30 a.m. on 13th August 2017, Kotopi landslide. More than 40 people in a bus, they got killed. Even a bike also was driven downwards into the valley. And so there were many people who became victims and it went down. So total number of casualties which were reported were about 46. So you can see that how even roads, our even vehicles, buildings, our forest, our our borders, our our bridges, they all can get affected. I'm showing another example from northeast, from the Sikkim area. Ganesh Top landslide, Amdogolai landslides, or within Gangtok area, even the newer constructions, they have failed because the regular domestic discharge into the slopes have been destabilizing it despite no rainfall. Chanmari landslide, very old infamous landslide, have been studied well through instrumentation and everything, and currently an early warning system has been installed on this by the Amrita University, and it's also need to be taken into account. Or even our heritage structures, the toy train lines, you can see the track is in the air because the landslide took away all the materials below it, and it had no support now. So this become dysfunctional, and this is a huge intangible loss to our heritage, which has been declared as heritage by the UNESCO, the toy train lines. So how do we protect and save themselves? Whether it is heritage, whether it is buildings, bridges, highways, vehicles, all these. Sonapur landslides, it was there, and now it's the treatment has been done on the roadside with a cut and cut. You can see how these buildings hanging in the air without any baseboards. So how much risk the people can take or are likely to take, you can see from such buildings. The Malin landslide in Maharashtra. Some people say it is because of the changing agricultural practices which became more mechanized. Or the reservoir area near to this in Ambegaon Tehsil. So this has also killed more than 140 people. Whole of the village, Malin village, it was washed away. And it was very difficult to actually recover the bodies. Day and night operations were carried out. Or in Goa. So you talk about any place in the country which is having hills. We have reported been casualties, landslides, or from Amburi, 2001. I remember it was November. I think it was 8th of November when a marriage function was going on in Amburi village, where at night suddenly there was heavy precipitation. And the landslide took place, and more than 38 people, they lost their lives. And this is all we have been looking into. 2005 Odikilla life loss, or 2007, so many lives and different buildings losses have been reported. Or 2018, you may be remembering the Kerala floods. They also brought several landslides and caused casualties. 2019, more than 50 people got killed in Kerala. So even the college buildings, educational buildings, the kind of domestic building damages where people were got killed. So you can see this is one of the college building which is affected in Idukki district. It's a government college at Munnar, which has been adversely affected by the occurrence of landslide. So Udupi, the picnic palaces, the tourism, one of the major economic activities in the hills, attractions. They are building a lot of hotels and guest houses and without any adequate planning. Or Karwar in the Karnataka area, Mysore. Remember 2009 August when the floods took place, a landslide also occurred. And more than about 19 people, they got buried and killed. You can see the position of the people, they were there as it is there before the event happened, and they didn't get even a time to escape from the event. So the bodies could be seen. Or Vishakhapatnam, one of my friends was talking, Venkatraman Ratnamji, that who attended our training at Vishakhapatnam. I could see a hill studded with buildings. Now just imagine, where is the space to for them to go, and how steep the slopes are, and what is the likely stability of such slopes? So how are our urban bodies, our authorities, they are doing? And now there is field data collection through mobile apps and through web application. International consortium, somebody was talking, is also working on world report on landslides. You can report to them through web or through mobile app, through NRSC or Geological Survey of India. And these are the places. It's not that we don't know about landslide. Landslide is one of those hazards which are best known or understood. And you know where it is likely to happen. Mostly, it is not an unexpected place. But sometimes time may not be exactly known. But so these are some of those areas where landslides have been happening, existing or old landslides area at the base of the land slopes or within the minor drainage hollows, where water can get accumulated, pore pressure can get generated, where vibrations can get affect, where the gravitational pull can bring the materials down, are the kind of situations that we can have landslides. And before it actually happens, it also gives a precursor signature. And it is in the form of sometimes the seepages or leakages or scarps or bulges or the tilting or differential settlements. I'm just listing some of these. I will not read everything due to shortage of time, because I want to cover so many things in this lecture. I'll show you instances from the field about this. This is a collective picture of various features that you can see. But I went to Dharamshala, and you can see the wall we normally construct in one alignment has got pushed forward. This is one of the indications that the ground is unstable, or the materials have fallen down, partially failed or retaining walls. Another important feature which can indicate instabilities, or the water leakages or seepages or leaching can also be one of the indicators of weakening of the areas. And sometimes it becomes deceptive in form that on the top you have a permeable layer, so all the water goes down. However, it will stop there, where you will find an impermeable layer. And if that layer is actually daylighting towards the valley, the slopes can become unstable or fail, or water can come out from there. So there, since this slope is standing, because the slope of the impermeable layer, where it is wet area on the downward side, is actually inclined inwards. Or you can even see back scars. So front part may be seeing intact, but the back part of the hill slopes can show movements, and a back scar can generate. Or enormous tilting of the bending of the trees can also be an indicator of long-term unstable slopes, with directions of movement and magnitude of movements which can be deciphered using dendrochronology. or the dispersion in the or shift in the middle lines of the highways and their disbursement, or you can see gapping between the windows and door frames with the walls. So all these are actually happening because of landslides or cracks within the floors on the ground within the buildings. So I'm showing all examples which we have seen in the field in landslide affected areas in different parts of India. And the wall cracks or the wall in the buildings. So everywhere you can, and some people try to monitor also those displacements. So basically, in order to manage landslide, one had to actually decipher that at right type of movements which is taking place, and also the type of material getting involved with the movement. So there are standard classifications at the international level, which one of them I have showed to you. Because of shortage of time, I'll not go in more detail, because each of these lectures we can spend hours. So this time is very limited for us. Just I'm showing you so that you can go in more detail and learn more about landslides. And then landslide features. Morphology is also similar to like a human body. We have a crown, we have a head, we have a left flank, we have right flank, we have a foot, we have a toe, we have a body. So all these features can be demarcated in any affected area. And then we can learn about the dimensions of the landslides and also the volume of the landslides. And then try to know about the causes of the landslides. And these causes can be classified in terms of geologic, geomorphic, and anthropogenic. Based on the type of cause we are studying, whether it is geological material or the structure or the discontinuity or the tectonic feature, we call it as weak or sensitive materials, weathered materials, sheared materials, fissured materials, or adverse discontinuities, oriented discontinuities, or contrasting permeabilities or stiffnesses. Morphological in terms of form of the slope. Form of the slope can be concave, convex, or flat. It may happen because of the tectonic or volcanic uplift or glacial rebound or fluvial or glacial erosion, or maybe subterranean erosion where you can find crevices, cracks, and underground openings, or freeze and thaw process, or shrink and swelling, particularly areas where you find clay minerals like montmorillonites or bentonite like materials. And man-made actions which are in terms of excavation, blasting, construction, or loading and unloading, deforestation, or forest fires, zoom cultivation, mining, irrigation, or artificial vibration, or leakages from the water supply lines or irrigation channels, etc. So these are some of those, and all these considered together, you can evaluate the risk and also prioritize that risk in terms of hazards to the elements and the degree of the hazards which are existing over there with respect to their exposure of the elements, the degree of the vulnerability of those elements, and the economic value of that element. It can be tangible or intangible, and indirectly proportionate to the capacity which we may normally measure in terms of strengths and attributes or attitudes of the affected community or resources available with them. Normally, I subscribe for the community level landslide risk reduction, these six steps in two phases. One is risk analysis, wherein you can do three steps, that is information on locality, community and environment, multi-hazard assessment, spatio-temporal, and then vulnerability and capacity assessment. Potential loss estimation is done through that. Then the second phase is multi-risk management, that is ranking hazards and prioritizing them, preparing, testing, and reviewing multi-risk management plan, and getting approval from the competent authorities, and implementing, monitoring, and evaluating the disaster risk management plan. Now I come to the solution part of it. Solution, the first thing is, either keep the hazard away from you or keep yourself away from the hazard. And I would suggest always avoidance and prevention are always better than cure and treatments for remediation of landslides. So avoidance can be done either letting the hazard continue in its own way, and we find our own way away from that. It can be done either by concrete sheds, over bridges, or some other kind of structures. And we can notice the movements of the landslides in those areas using the landslide precursors. So this is one of the examples where landslides has been happening and the tunnel has been constructed, and the vehicle traffic will continue and the landslide will. This is at the Sonapur, where a cut and cover tunnel was constructed, and this traffic could continue and landslide is continuing in its own path. Concrete shed, from the example from Japan sites, putting the signboards for people to avoid their encounters with the landslides. So if they know, and they will walk carefully, take precautions, and they will not get encounters with the landslides. So such boards are also good means of avoiding encounters and becoming victims of the landslides. And for safer constructions, we have also developed certain guidelines and materials, and the state disaster management authorities have also given. So where to construct, siting is very important, development is another important, and construction is third important issue, and then maintenance and management. So all these steps in their local vernacular languages, but our usage of those land areas, despite all best efforts, will affect the stability of the slopes. For putting garbage, I remember the garbage Porvorim landslide in Goa actually blocked the connection of the Goa from the adjoining states for about more than a month, and that landslide actually initiated because of the garbage heap that was there, through which the water got infiltrated and surcharged the slopes of the clay materials in between the dock beds. And this kind of degradation, but then putting the plastics and materials which cause problems. So we must look into this and then opt for structural measures and non-structural measures. Structural measures are physical constructions. It can be a retaining wall, it can be a reinforcement structures, or it can be some kind of protection structures. So we will talk about it, and it will depend on the type of material that you are using and type of technique that you are using with that material to provide prevention and protection against the landslide risk. There can be some diversion structures, deflection structures, or also some structures which may be in the form of strengthening short cutting, grouting, netting, etc., which we will talk. So all these measures have been listed, and the measures which are also including the drainage measures can also be considered under the structural measures. Non-structural measures are actually pertaining to policies, procedures, guidelines, regulations, rules which need to be followed in order to contain the occurrence of the landslides, and restricting development in landslide prone areas making use of landslide hazard zonation map, and also including those maps in our land use planning, construction and developmental activities to minimize risk or exposure to the landslide hazards. This kind of the stitching on the slopes have been very much common in Japan, being part of the international this coordination. I have seen that this is common in Japan but not common in India, and these need to be taken up. And another good thing that I found in other countries is that they are preferring to opt for drainage measures more than the other physical construction measures like the retaining walls. So drainage measures are one of the best measures, whereas the construction of retaining walls may not be. So we should look into this. So both surface and subsurface drains can be provided, or even sometimes wells can be provided. So all these I will show you, all these have been done. You can see the culvert, a side drain in a hill slope area, a well constructed side drains, and cleanliness and maintenance of those drains is very important before the monsoon season, when maximum amount of water is likely to come along with the debris which can block. So capacities may get reduced if this debris is not clear. And the drainage should actually plan with the natural flows, not just from the drains. So sometimes the narrow drains are created using a drain in an office without looking into the field conditions. So that normally doesn't work. You may construct a drain on a hill slope, unstable hill slope, but that may not actually bring any benefit. And sometimes even the drain is there, properly done, but it is not properly maintained. Then also the water will continue to infiltrate into the slope and destabilize it. And the purpose of the line drain will not be served to stabilize. Or French drain, collecting the water from all the sides and disposing it through central drains, through a midstream. And then the drainage wells, these I have seen in Japan, they had subsurface drainage pipes, and through these drainage pipes they were collecting water into the well, and from that well they were disposing of that water. So the waters were coming down, and what was there in the wells, and also drainage tunnels. Now these are the measures they thought are very appropriate and economical in long terms, rather than relocating and shifting people from any area. These were there in some of the villages which were actually affected by landslide, but inhabited by human beings. So they thought that they will stabilize these slopes, they will minimize the possibility or severity of the landslide, and they took all potential preventive measures or mitigative measures in such forms. Flexible drainage systems they have corrected. So these are the drainage pipes through which they collected the water and then disposed to the tanks, and you can see leaching also. So they had actually numbered, indexed each drain pipe so that they know from where the maximum waters are coming, from where the subsurface infiltrations are taking place. So these were very effective techniques, and not only managing the subsurface water but also the surficial water through damming, through construction of walls, and the walls having the weep holes through which water started coming down, and not allowing the water to get into the slopes so that they remain stable. So these are some of these examples. Excavation and removal of the materials, regradation, because I said morphology plays a role. So why not change the morphology, change the gradient, and or change the relative relief so that the stability of the slopes can be ensured, or change the characteristics of the material composing the slopes so that it doesn't get easily detached or displaced or deformed. So all these things are possible if we understand the nature of the slope, the behavior of the slope over a period of time and space. So retaining structures may be in terms of retaining walls or even piles, buttresses, counterweights, tie rods, anchors, rock bolts, dowels. So different types of arrangements of the cut stones, they can be made within cellular the machinery wall, cut stone machinery walls, and then with weep holes and side drains, or the random boulders arranged within a cellular structure with walls in between, or with the opening joints to accommodate the freeze and thaw process, shrinking and swelling processes, and also providing the drains like this in a downward direction. Sometimes the drainages are provided, but they deep inward, so the water doesn't come out of the slope through gravitative process. So these have to be understood how it's to be done. Or maybe the wire created given walls, you create a basket, put different types of material stones together and arrange them in the form of a wall, and it acts as a protection structure. It restrains the movements, acts as a gravity wall. Or you can use geosynthetics, geotextile, geomembranes to cover the slopes and also to construct the walls to create actually the friction against the potential movements, or multi-tiered walls or multi-step walls. So many such, but these all need adequate foundations, then only they can remain stable. Otherwise, you can see the kind of consequences where the two retaining structures I am showing you, on one side they had a proper foundation, on the other side without proper foundation the similar structures were, retaining walls were constructed. You can see they had subsided and failed, so it doesn't work. So we have to see that appropriate foundation needs to be there, and sometimes even for wire cutted along the channels, and the use of the waste materials like empty bitumen drums for inhibiting the slope movements. So many kind steps have been taken up at different levels by different departments, and they actually helped, or gunny bags. So particularly in the areas where you cannot make permanent physical constructions. For example, I remember when I went to Goa, they have an area which is declared as heritage area because Portuguese used to live there, and that was a colony of the Portuguese, and they also made some, but landslides happened, and they were actually cannot make any physical constructions there. So they have only these kind of temporary remediation techniques using the retaining structures like the gunny bags filled with debris materials like these structures. Or you can create a cellular structure and fill that with some materials. It can be a precast concrete wall, it can be a steel structure, or it can be a timber structure, or whatever you may like. Or you can use girders like timber walls. So many such things have been done and are available. Or at the river level, the basal cutting, the toe cutting can also result into landslides, which we term as toe-induced landslides. And this can be prevented by correcting crossbars, minimizing the velocity of the waters and the erosion caused by these waters. So these are the issues, and also vegetation can help, not only by holding the materials surfacially at shallower areas through the root networks, but also through evapotranspiration transpiration mechanisms, or some kind of chemical freezing, thermal treatments or grouting treatments can also help. Now, as I said, it depends on the type of the process of the landslides. Accordingly, the treatment measures or preventive measures to be decided. These are all measures which I just spoke to you were depending on the slide area, that is the rotational, translational or wedge type of landslides. Now, if you come to debris flows or debris avalanches, we have different type of measures. It involves check dams, it involves deflection walls, it involves debris basins, it involves debris fences, deflection walls, or channelization of the debris materials, or you can have the impact spreading walls, or stem walls, or vegetation barriers. So these are the kind of structures which have been created along the path of the debris flow area. You create hindrances, allow only small stones to come or water only to come through such structures, and then the impacts can be reduced. Or create a debris basin like this, which has been done, or check dams, so many, or timber check dams, so many such things. And similarly for rock falls, we have benching, excavation, sling, framing, chains, cables, so buttresses, dentitions, rock trap ditches, catch nets, catch walls, rock shed. So all these are available, and have been taken. This is the measures of anchors with tie beams integrated together with each other so that they don't let each unit to fail. And this was done at Governor's Palace in Goa, which was having problems due to landslides. So even the VIP buildings can get affected, not only the heritage or a common man's buildings. Even I remember in Dharamshala when I was working, their MPs, perhaps her name was Chandresh Kumari, her house was affected by landslide at that time, which we studied and tried to help them on caging nets of different types. All these detailed information you can get from different organizations. Or you may have these kind of drainage galleries to prevent. You can let the disaster go underneath and you continue the traffic, or reduce their energy and momentum so that the severity and impacts can be reduced. Or by engineering measure using jute mats, jute bags, or other structure or seedlings there, and then continue the monitoring and early warning system using different surface observation techniques or remote observation techniques using piezometers, settlement gauges, crack meters, extensiometers, scanners, radars, or satellite images, optical signatures, nanoseismics, acoustics, etc. So all these being used by people in different parts of the world. In India, we have been using some of these techniques, but to very limited extent. This is previous example was the example of application of a real-time automated target recognition system, which I used at Uttarkashi and Burnawat landslide. And this is a extensiometer that was used by Japanese in one of the landslide area, or inclinometer, and also using the CCTVs and solar panels for getting the active landslide there whenever it starts movements, and also we are giving alerts using sirens. You can see the pole has a siren, the CCTV and headlights, so that all kind of informations, and they have in the office getting all the information from the site using the CCTV, also satellite images and the site instrumentation data through the data loggers, and then analyzing those information and passing early warning and alerts to the affected community of those areas, and doing experimental models in the laboratories using various rainfall intensities, distributions and displacements. And these are the kind of studies that have been done in Japan. In India, they are still in a preemptive state. Not eliminating the cracks, or using the boreholes, borehole camera, and landslide generation maps, and bringing them into practice for the probability and the intensity of the landslides, and giving them prescriptions for actions to be taken, and developments and constructions with the demonstration examples. Maybe through sketches or through models or through memorials, exhibition parks, or our education centers. Some good field examples I've seen where they have constructed along the contours with the minimum of interfaces with the landslides, and also rockfall areas being also constructed without taking care of protection measures or mitigation measures, which are exposing the population to the high risk of landslides. And the good practices in terms of preemptive mitigation or preventive measures before the construction, and adequate foundations and drainage measures being taken with bioengineering techniques as well. So mainstream DRR has been done through our finance ministry, Ministry of Finance actually, through its expenditure finance committee, and also DPRs, detailed project reports. They have prescribed certain actions, and they have suggested an integrated holistic approach rather than piecemeal ad hoc approach or reactive approach to landslides, and that required not only the government agency but also involving the communities and also the corporate social responsibilities and public private partnerships for landslide risk reduction and resilience. So these are already talked to you. So I'll not go in more details, and these are the codes. Many of these codes are available, and portals, networks are also available. BSI is our nodal agency for landslide management studies. So we can involve GSI and then follow the national guidelines. We had done collaborations with the international partners, including not only the Japanese agencies like NILIM, PWRI, but also like ITC Netherlands, BGR Germany, or CNR, IRPI, Italy, and so on, and ICL. And we have even signed MOUs with them and represented the country with them and had workshops in their country, in our country, conducted the training programs, made our function is aware and informed, gave them state of art technology, hands-on trainings, and also through video conferencing methods, through tabletop exercises, and also making them to work upon those problematic areas and discussion and then decision making, and also through demonstrations for all phases of disaster management, and visits to the library for testing in the laboratories, and also in situ testes to the state emergency operation centers and to the sites, explaining the how to study a landslide in the field, how to face a landslide in the field, and how to demarcate a landslide in the field, how to calculate the volumes, dimensions, or features, type of processes, etc. in the field. So all these are done, and we are also conducting international webinars and also sharing our case studies with our participants, bringing the private partners also and state of art technologies. And we have our standard operational procedures for early warning, which are also shared, and you can go through these, and you can find these at our websites of NIDM, NDMA, and MHA. And we are also trying to work with the communities, because until and unless the communities or citizens do not participate, our efforts will not succeed well. So we are trying to involve them, involve the local ambassadors, local heroes, popular figures, so that the public gets involved through their cultural, social, and institutional means, and bringing the tools, techniques, and technologies from the international level. We have established the World Center of Excellence on Landslide Disaster Reduction. That was there from 2011 to 14, now also 2020 to 2023. And we are also conducting workshops on specific disasters and bringing the highest levels for the workshops and all stakeholders, talking about them and documenting the lessons learned, and also guiding the research or internships and dissertations on the specific types of hazards or cases, case studies, and conducting workshops at the international and national levels. And these are national and international conferences. You can see our minister, Nitin Jikishan Reddy, is there. So Ministry of Home Affairs. And we are also producing the conference proceedings, volumes, and training module on landslides, both in English and Hindi, director of institutions, bibliographic databases, case studies, preparedness guidelines, and both in Hindi and English, for student level, school levels, journal for researchers for specific issues also being published, and online programs being conducted. Self-study program is available free of cost, nidmssp.in, which you can approach. Or international VKP is also there, and you can also find the international guidelines being shared from other countries, and the Kyoto landslide protocol commitment is also there for 2015 to 2025, that is being followed up, and the cases where landslide affected buildings has been preserved as a guide, as a field park or museum for people to learn from it. And they are putting all the case studies with the case examples and similar things we also need to demarcate and create our own disaster prevention and education centers with the memorial museums, keeping the memories of the recent and past disasters. So we have to work all together in terms of standards and improved technologies and methodologies for landslide hazard generation, prescribe the adequate numbers of input layers which are minimally required, and field data as must be collected minimally, and regulating public issues of hazard and risk map for their implementation, and preventing publication of unethical and unauthenticated research outputs. As you were told that I have a responsibility as national coordinator of International Association for Promoting Geoethics, I would advise that kindly do validate your information, data and outcomes before you share it with the public or publish it in reputed journals. Multidisciplinary approach to landslide management in a digital platform. We are now talking about digital slope risk assessment and management systems, site specific mitigation measures, time and duration to be given for emphasis for the implementation part. Scale is very important in landslide studies. Site specific scales are very much different. We have been doing it on 1:100 scale or 500 scale to 1:1,000,000 of scale, depending on the requirement and purpose of the study. Establish adequately distributed network of meteorological informations, data and softwares, thresholds and early warning systems. Traditional coping mechanisms must also be given adequate weightages. Land use and settlement policies effectively required. Debris disposal is one of the important points to be considered, because mostly these debris which is generated by landslide is thrown downstream side, causing another problem within the rivers or those slopes. So therefore we must look into that. Rehabilitation for those which have to be relocated and or which have been affected or which who have lost or become homeless after a landslide. At the national level, we have a calamity relief fund which is now available in the form of response funds. So from where the mechanisms have been well defined, procedures have been given by the Ministry of Home Affairs, and also other programs and systems and missions have also to be integrated with it, the disaster risk reduction process, including the climate change and extreme weather events. Innovations in terms of tetrapod usages or double diaphragm wall at Kalyasur site, or highlighting the bad practices in terms of constructions along the drainages, and good practices in terms of constructions along the contours. And no one can do it alone. We have to join hands together, build partnerships, and then work towards landslide risk reduction and resilience. Our dream is to build a disaster resilient and disaster free India. With these words, I thank you. I found this stone on a crossroad in Japan. You move it in any direction, it will quickly regain its position. Japanese say their country is on the islands which get exposed to earthquakes, tsunami, floods, avalanches, landslides, zone. But their society has to become resilient like the stone to recover as quickly as possible. And I will also receive during my works all the support and encouragement from all sectors and every human being. But the best thing I found was this particular monkey with its baby. It came to the car which was at that time given to me for the field work by the son of the famous the priest of the famous temple, Vishwanath temple in Uttarkashi. So I was supported by the government, by the administration, by the community. But the wild hostile life also become hospitable and affectionate when I was trying to actually monitor and restore the forest area which was its habitat. So not only the human beings but also the wild hostile life actually considers it good if you do appropriate and effective disaster risk reduction and resilience, and disaster management does provide you those opportunities. Save others, save yourselves, protect yourself and protect others. So your safety is first, then you can save others. So we should look into this and then continue our efforts toward disaster risk reduction and resilience. That's all for today. If there are any question, I would be happy to undertake.
Yes, sir.
So I will stop the PPT here, no? Okay.
Yes, sir, you can stop. Okay, sir, thank you so much for such a wonderful talk. And by also, and thanks for showing us amazing examples with the help of many pictures. Sir, we have some questions from the YouTube live chat box. Sir, first question is, what is the shortcoming that is lacking in case of landslide prediction?
Shortcoming?
Yes, sir.
See, shortcomings are in terms of implementation measures primarily, that we do not have actually affordability of the good instruments which are normally being imported from outside. For example, inclinometers, they are not indigenously developed or built, except a few. No, others have to be imported. Similarly, extensiometers. So indigenous development of economically affordable equipments and instrumentation is very important, which should have a reliable, credible sensors which can be monitored. Nowadays, actually, some of the institutions has actually tried. For example, IIT Mandi had developed some sensors to monitor the rainfall amounts and also fix up the thresholds. Similarly, now GSI is also working. Amrita University is doing with the network sensors. They have also already done in Kerala. Now they are doing in Sikkim. But what we actually need in terms of prediction capabilities, one, we need skilled human resources. I remember when I was doing the use of the automated target recognition system, that was the first time in the country that we had imported that Leica system, TDA 5005, and first time that automated target recognition system was being used within the country for an active landslide to monitor and provide information. And the task was not easy because it required a lot of information to fix the stations, to see the site, and also to see the credibility of our data. No? So predictions depend on not only the instruments, the periodicity of the measurements, but also the skills, attributes and attitude of the human resources who are working on it. So it's not always required to be going for very costly equipments. For example, when I started with the Varnavart at that time, I used very simple techniques which could be indigenously developed and executed. So whereas in other countries which are rich, they do differently. So if we talk in terms of our own Indian environment, we have to actually devise our own ways. I could see when I was collaborating with Japanese, they also showed me some indigenous equipment which were very quiet, cheap and could be easily constructed or made by the local people. So lot of gaps are still there which need to work, and it's still not a very common practice. I showed you some of the figures. You see that there is a wall that has a paper put up, and they were putting the date and time of the when the paper got ruptured. Some people are also using the glass strips. When it ruptures, it generates sound, so they know the exact time and they put up the board. So then some people are using for crack gauge measurements, some type of strain meters and crack meters using the wooden crack meters. So number of such type, or sometimes some people are using sensors, multi-sensors, nowadays using same borehole. So drilling in the hills is not easy. Accessing those areas is not that easy. Those are other difficulties that can be found.
So the next question is, which methods is best for landslide prediction, statistical or artificial intelligence?
See, landslide prediction, you are talking in terms of slope stability assessment. Landslide prediction has to be, actually we talk in terms of case specific, site specific, then only it is useful for our early warning system. But in terms of landslide hazard assessment, we have to use a mix of techniques. You cannot say this is better and the other is not good. Depending on the governing factors or site conditions, the techniques can be decided. There cannot be a universal tool or technology that can apply to all places. I'm sorry. Because the nature of the slopes is variable, material is variable, and use is variable. Morphology is variable, drainage is variable, climate and meteorology is variable, forest land cover is variable. So we have to decide depending on suitability of that technique. So statistical techniques are actually using the past data or the scientific database in an objective manner, right? But even the expert experience is also very important, or local community's experience is also very important. So that we have to consider collectively, not in an isolated manner. Okay?
Okay, sir. So the next question is by Yamini Malhotra. How disaster management dealt with pandemic in the past 2 months when condition was pathetic, and how geometeorological department of NIDM deal with it?
Actually, this pandemic being from disaster management, although not directly part of geometeorological risks, but we have to deal with it as part of disaster management. And for your kind information, we have a Disaster Management Act 2005, Act 53 of 2005, which has listed down the roles and responsibilities of different organizations and institutions at the national level, state level, and district level, or even at the local levels, and given us empowerment legally, financially, and administratively. So most of the protocols and procedures and guidelines which have been issued during this period, they were because of the provisions under the Disaster Management Act 2005, that the containment zones, the curfew, and all other lockdown procedures were possible because of Disaster Management Act. So in the pandemics, we had the Epidemics Act 1897, we had the Epidemics Ordinance 2020, and also the applications of Disaster Management Act widely being applied in the pandemic situation to control the situation. No, and then IT Act 2000. So these are the legal mechanisms that we had utilized. And being part of a national issue of disaster management, we actually conducted a lot of programs and activities during this period since January, February 2020. After we learned this is likely to happen, and the first the guidelines were issued for preventing the entry of outsiders within the country, and tracing, testing, and treatment measures. This was done by NIDM to create awareness, spread information, and prepare people against the pandemic risks, and sharing of experiences. And we conducted so many webinars, conferences, training programs on pandemics. And also, Honorable Prime Minister during October 2020 actually started a public movement called as Jan Andolan for appropriate behavior during COVID-19. So that message was also spread out to the masses through NIDM. And we were also keeping all the watch and documentation on the actions being taken by different states We were also part of the interministerial central teams. So a lot of steps, we were more busy than other times during these periods because of pandemics. And pandemics with other hazards was another major challenge. Cyclones had happened, you know, Amphan had happened, Taute has happened, Yashi has happened, and now we had landslide in Maharashtra. Our operations by our National Disaster Response Force is also become a big challenge, and new directions and strategies need to be opted for that. Okay.
Yes, sir. The next question is by Sudarshan Ramakrishnan. Please explain river belt zone and people affected from the flood. What should they do to save from that flood in the village? For example, he has written Kollaroon River of Tamil Nadu.
I tell you, actually, there are zonation techniques we are talking about. Along with there is a prescription, particularly for flood. We have prohibited areas, we have restricted areas, and we have permitted areas. Now, wherever river is flowing, it has its own plane. It has a nature of shifting. So we should not actually provide any construction or do any permanent constructions in those areas. And these should be declared as prohibited areas. Okay. Maybe you can do temporary, transitory, some activities, but not regular activities. And that too, keeping in mind the situation at that time. Okay. Then restricted areas, they are little elevated areas. Okay. Which are likely to get affected by inundation and flooding situations. So, we may have damages and losses. So, restricting those developments as per standards and codes for flood risk reduction and resilience or resistance should be followed. Those restrictions have to be applied for any development or construction in those areas. Permitted areas are quite above the flood inundation areas. They are not there, you will not get the water or flood impacts. So there you can go ahead with normal practices of construction. For example, in restricted areas, a prescription is that there should be an elevated structure, no? So that the ground floor doesn't get affected.
Yes.
And in urban areas, there will be still different situations. So many situations will governing the, actually the, that's why I talk about local environment and community. How they behave, what they do, what are the constructions and practices, what is the natural environment, and what are the anthropogenic changes there. Okay.
Yes, sir. So next question is by Sangeeta. Sir, how can I analyze an avalanche and what data, DEM or DTM, is used to analyze that risk?
Actually, I should not answer this question, because currently I'm not doing that task, okay? Because always there are developments. Now my duties are more towards knowing what is being done and how that benefits of the current research, knowledge and practices can be brought to the respective departments and the communities who are affected by them. So here is the gap. Then now, she has talked about DEM, DTM. No doubt they are required and we need to study them. And 3D modeling is being done nowadays. And there are number of models which have been developed by very good organizations from Switzerland. And they have done good works. And they're actually collaborating with our Department of the Defense Geoinformatic Research Establishment. Earlier, we had SASE, which was working on avalanches, which is the nodal avalanche, which was a nodal agency for avalanche risk reduction. So, for the research purposes, if she wants to know more, she should rather approach to DGRE, who are working in details on that, then I think a person like me, who may not be well aware about the current techniques or tools, because I deal now with meant several types of hazards. And for me, every hazard is important that can turn into a disaster. So that's my limitation.
Okay, sir. Now the question is by Prosoon Kumar Ghosh. Why northeastern extreme of India is mostly affected by landslide?
Easternmost area?
Yes, sir. Northeastern.
Northeastern?
Yes, sir.
Northeastern area is affected by landslides. In fact, they have many wet slopes. But when you go for actually satellite remote sensing techniques for risk assessments, because those are wet slopes, you cannot easily see the scars, or it's not easy to distinguish the unstable slopes compared to the northwestern area, which is actually having higher exposure and clear images. So those limitations are there. And both the areas, northeast and northwest, are almost equally affected, because in the northwestern, they also have very high intensity rainfalls, wet slopes, and thick forest areas. Okay.
Yes,
and I remember there was landslides in Manipur, Aizawl landslide I shared with you. I shared landslides from Sikkim. I shared some of the landslides from Arunachal. I shared landslide from Meghalaya. All the 8 states of northeastern region, in fact, if you talk in terms of disaster management, are affected by landslides, flash floods, and earthquakes very much.
Yes, sir. Now the question is by Poonam. What is the role of District Disaster Management Authority?
Their roles, as I told you, are well defined in our Disaster Management Act 2005. A full chapter has been dedicated for district level disaster management authority. And what will be the constitution of the disaster management authority, and how they can function, and what will be their roles and responsibilities. Primarily, if I have to provide you information about the role, is their role is overarching, collecting all the information related to any prevalent or potential hazard within their district, their administrative area, and then taking adequate proactive steps to avoid, to prevent, to mitigate, to prepare, and to efficiently respond and recover from that disaster is the main, and the preparation of for formulation of district level disaster management plan, and looking into all concerned agencies and departments or institutions which are working there within their administrative territory to make their own plans, and linking them with the district disaster management plan.
Majid Hassan is asking, sir, we have got policies, plans, and everything required to reduce hazard risk, but the execution part is lagging. So why to allow the construction in landslide prone areas and risk people's lives?
See, development or growth or construction is equally required as the disaster risk reduction. We have to keep a balance. Okay. That's why we are talking in terms of sustenance and resilience. You need comforts also. You want to exploit natural resources also. Okay. You continue with mining also. You need sand also. You need cement also. No? And you need concrete also. So everything is required. But not going to an extent that it becomes threatening to our life, economy, environment, or resources in long terms. So what we actually need is what he is saying is the reduce the gap in terms of reinforcements, in terms of implementation of regulations and rules for risk reduction and resilience. So what we normally do is we make always a compromise for the gains against certain risks. For example, every day you are moving on the roads despite knowing that there are so many accidents, and highest number of deaths are happening because of road accidents. But still you don't stop moving in vehicles. or you don't ban the routes or ban the vehicles on the routes, okay, because you know that it is required. So what we do is we make traffic signals, we keep some regulations for traffic to move, for road to to be used by the people in an appropriate manner, so that road accidents can be minimized. So our purpose is to reduce the risk to the minimum levels and go for a sustainable and resilient, safer developments, okay? And for that, every citizen has to play a conscious role. We see so many things going wrong around us, but we don't object to it, or we don't raise our hands, or we don't intervene. We say it's not my duty. Until unless, that's why we call for culture of prevention, mitigation and preparedness. Culture means everybody has to become conscious to take initiatives and actions or interventions for risk reduction and resilience, then only it will become effective.
Okay, okay sir. Now the other question is by Shobhik Mandal. How contrast in permeability causes landslides?
I showed some example of permeability contrast, that where you have highly permeable materials, water will go down very fast. Okay, so if water goes down, it is not withheld between the pore spaces, it will not create pressure. But when it goes down to an impermeable layer, its rate of infiltration or percolation stops or reduces, okay, to a great extent. And now that water which is present within those pores of the materials actually pushes in all directions, right? Downward push because of the gravity, hydrostatic pressure, and outward push because of the availability of the space to push outwards, bulging, okay? Upward push is opposite to gravity, so doesn't affect that lot. Inward because of opposition from the back materials. So it is the outward and the downward pore water pressure that will create the instability or the forces for material to move. Okay.
Yes. The other question is by Vishwaranjan. What is your suggestion to mitigate reoccurring floods in Maharashtra?
See, we say we understand. See, half of the problems are resolved. We know the causes, the sources, the factors affecting any problem. And flood is one of those disasters which are quite well understood. Since time immemorial, when the human civilization started, we lived very close to the rivers. And we had witnessed how the floods have been happening around us. Okay? It's not because of dearth of knowledge, but it is because of our intent to reduce it, to take adequate steps, because of our own greed or self-interest is to get some benefits. Okay, so we know the precipitation. Now meteorological forecasts are good. We know the river areas, their capacities. We know the drainage capacities. So everything is known. What is actually not known is the intent and the actions or the interventions by the people at the local level. Until and unless that is not going ahead positively and proactively with the good strength promoting risk reduction and resilience, all this knowledge will not bring benefit. Knowledge, unless it is practiced, will not bring benefits. No, you don't become wise just by knowing the things. You become wise by taking the actions, doing the things.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Okay, sir. The next
you become intellectual, intelligent by knowing the things, not yes, wise. wise person only knows the action. No, everybody has a degree. Everybody got information. But till you take it to the field and practice, or you will not know the. Like, for example, we have a proverb, no? Only the wearer knows where the shoe pinches. So we have to be part of that game.
Yes. Okay? So the other question is by Vivek. What is the correlation between number of bore well density with respect to landslide risk in hilly areas?
That again will vary. You cannot define, no? I cannot state outrightly this is should be the density, because it will be variable depending on local conditions. So nobody should actually state like that.
So, next question is by Mohsin. Government has recently announced gas pipeline project to Jammu and Kashmir. Sir, how can it really happen, keeping in view of terrain and landslides along the specified route?
I've given you example of Kobe earthquake, 2005. In fact, in earthquake on, I think it was 19th January 1995, when it had happened, I remember the Japanese at that time were using timber building in order to remain safe against earthquake vibrations compared to the concrete buildings. Okay, what happened at that time, they had these kind of gas pipelines which was underlain around those buildings, PNG. And those pipelines, both trunk and service pipelines, they got ruptured. And during that earthquake, with the leakage of gas from these service and trunk gas pipelines, the fire got triggered. And these timber buildings, which were constructed to resist against earthquake, got fire because of that gas leakage. And more than around 5,000 people got killed. So in Jammu and Kashmir, when we are talking specific, Jammu and Kashmir is prone to earthquake. I remember 8th October 2010, there was an earthquake of magnitude more than 7, which caused several landslides. And if pipelines are also there, these pipelines also can get ruptured and can leak gas. So whenever such projects or infrastructure is laid down, we must think about the prevailing hazards in those areas and take adequate protective actions and measures so that they don't get affected, or even if they get affected, they don't cause disasters. So we must look into all that. I've been dealing with the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas. I've dealt with several of their organization for oil, petroleum and other areas. And I've been discussing with them that they have to look into the hazard scenarios while laying down their infrastructure, pipelines or processing plants, or they have to look into the safety at all levels. They have upstream, midstream, downstream projects, offshore projects, onshore projects. They have to prepare their plans at on-site and off-site. So they have too much thing of variabilities, and they have to think about everything.
Yes, sir. The next question is by Ashok Kumar Tyagi. Government of India should strictly introduce the concept of clearance from NIDM, independent of environment clearance, for major construction or industrial initiatives at pan-India level at the earliest. What is your take, doctor?
Actually, environment impact analysis in early 80s, when there was a raised awareness and movements on environment, the Environment Act had come. And that led to the establishment of procedures for environmental impact assessment. Okay. Now, Disaster Management Act 2005 had come. Subsequent to that, the Ministry of Finance, as I discussed with you also, they issued EFC guidelines and also the DPR guidelines for disaster risk reduction and resilience. And they also provided a format also for risk auditing, disaster risk auditing for any new project or existing project. Okay. We see it from two angles. One, whether that development activity which is happening can get affected by existing hazards or prevailing or potential hazards in those areas. Okay. Other is whether this development can generate new risk or bring new potential disasters. Okay. And how those what are we doing to prevent, mitigate those disasters or prepare against those disasters? So it is both ways. So disaster risk auditing, no doubt, is very much required, is need of the day. And the recent disaster which took place on 7th February 2021 in Uttarakhand, in the Joshimath block of Chamoli district, when the NTPC project and Rishi Ganga power projects were adversely affected, the risk auditing in the exploration and the planning stage, in the construction stage, was also considered to be important. And some of the this is no doubt has to be there, should be there. I would recommend that strongly.
Okay, sir. Sir, there are a lot of questions.
Just to add here, Garima.
Yes, sir.
Just to add here, Garima, sir, if you give me the liberty of speaking for 1 minute. I was just saying that many of the developing economies, considering the present increase of rate of the disasters, okay, they have brought up the disaster clearance, you know, in parallel with the environmental clearance, because environmental clearance are for the long term disaster perspective, but when you talk in terms of disaster clearance, it means that the current disasters or the current pattern of the way we work in the industries or in the construction industry, how do we have checks and balances, and a timely intervention of institute like yours, okay, would actually strengthen the environmental ministry and the state governments in terms of having a check. And many of the developing economies have brought parallel rulings around it. And if you want, I can share some of that material with you, and maybe you can throw it, you can put it across to the people who matters in terms of creating rules for the country. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Actually, sir, there are a lot of questions, and some of the questions are very common, which you have already explained in the slides. So I request the participant to go to the YouTube live the session again and see the slides. Okay, sir, thank you so much for accepting our invitation for the talk, and your talk was very interesting and very wonderful. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Garima ji, and I hope the participants may have got some benefits out of this talk. And thanks to the organizers for hosting this talk. And this actually was to also highlight the role of earth sciences, environmental sciences and engineering, as well as social sciences and humanitarian sciences in disaster risk reduction and resilience. So no one is complete until unless we join hands with each other. Last mein main kahunga, kisi shayar ne kaha hai, nazar badlo, nazare badal jayenge. सोच बदलो सितारे बदल जाएंगे, कश्तियों को बदलने की जरूरत नहीं यारो, दिशा बदलो किनारे बदल जाएंगे. सो यू हैव टू मूव योर डायरेक्शंस फ्रॉम डिजास्टर्स टू सेफ्टी एंड रिस्क रिडक्शन एंड रेजिलियंस. सो विद दीज वर्ड्स आई थैंक ईच एंड एवरीवन फॉर पार्टिसिपेटिंग इन दिस प्रोग्राम एंड लिसनिंग पेशेंटली एंड रेजिंग क्वेश्चंस एंड आंसर, मेकिंग इट इंटरेक्टिव एंड एक्टिव फॉर बोथ द साइड्स. Thank you very much
for enlightening us.
Thank you, sir.
See you.
Can I quit now?
Yes, sir, you can.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.